Marriage is a sacred institution that joins together a man and a woman, a husband and a wife in holy matrimony, and each with their God-given duties to one another. Previously, we considered the duties of husbands who are committed to love their wives, to respect their wives, and to support their wives. Now we're going to consider that the apostles taught that there were specific duties of wives also, beginning with one that seems to offend a lot of people, particularly in our day and time. We don't like the word submission because we're such a free society, and also we are a society that likes to have its own mind, our own individuality, and basically we just want to do what we want to do. We really shy away from this word submit. But actually, submission is really, it's a very wonderful thing. It's a blessing. Because when you are under the authority or under the covering of someone else, not only do you have the blessing that is related from that covering and that authority, you have the protection from that covering and that authority. But we want to define this word submit. The Greek word is hupotasso, and it means to subordinate or to obey. I want to say that submission in the kingdom of God is never something that is demanded or extracted from someone. In the kingdom of God, submission is always something that is yielded or given. You can't force people to submit. Submission is an attitude of the heart, and wives, need to be taught that, and they need to be willing to learn that. It has to come from the heart. It has to be something that's willingly given. To be under obedience, in subjection to submit self unto. That's the Strong's definition. Lou Nida defines it as to submit to the orders or directives of someone. An example would be Jesus submitting to the will of his Father. And wives are to submit to their husbands. Ephesians 5:22-24, as the church submits to Christ in everything. We're going to read that again. I know we read that last night, but let's take a look at that again, because that is a foundation text in all that we're teaching this weekend, but specifically here this morning as we relate to wives and husbands, again, particularly the wife this morning. Ephesians chapter 5:22-24. And the scripture says, wives, submit to your own husbands. And it does specifically say your own husbands. So, you're not being asked by God to submit to all husbands or men everywhere. But as unto the Lord, it says, for the husband is the head of the wife, and also Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. So he's giving us some reasons, some examples why you would want to submit, and also the example of Christ. Therefore, just as the church is subject to Christ, let the wives be to their own husbands as in everything. So we read the scripture here. So it points out to us, as Christ is as the church submits to Christ in everything. Everything's a strong word, but that is what the scripture says. And then it's in Acts chapter 5, verse 25, presuming that it is in keeping with the will of God. So God never expects us to submit to our husband if it's contrary to the will of God. So if a husband is asking a wife to do something that is, it's very clearly not in line with the scriptures. If your husband says, let's go down to the bar and drink and, get crazy. Well, you can say, look, in my heart, I am submitted to you. I want to please you and I want to have, a nice time with you. Why don't we go to a nice place and have dinner together? But, the Bible tells us that we're to flee the appearance of evil. The Bible tells us that, we're not to have strong drink. The Bible tells us that we're not to be drunk in we're in his excess, but to be filled with the Holy Ghost. Why don't we go to church and get full of the Holy Ghost? You see what I'm saying? Then, you know, the woman has a clear reason there to say to her husband with a submitted heart, I don't think I'm going to go with you to do that. She's not being rebellious, or she's not being, one who's not in subjection to her husband. She's appealing to the higher power, which is God. And she's remaining in a lawful place in that relationship. And then 1 Peter 3:7 says, for husbands must not abuse their authority. So, he may not be doing it intentionally. He may not know the scriptures, perhaps, but she has a responsibility to recognize that as something that, you know, he really doesn't have the right to ask her as a fellow Christian, as one who is a joint heir with Christ, as someone who is a sister in the Lord. And so she has a right to not join him in that venture. Amen? So Ephesians 5:25-27, husbands are to love the wives as Christ loves the church. How many of you know he probably wouldn't stand up in church that morning and say, let's all go drinking and dancing? He probably wouldn't do that, amen? If he did, I would hope the rest of the church would say, no, we're not going. I'd hope they wouldn't all pile in the car with him, right? That wouldn't be good. Amen? Okay, so even as Christians, wives are to submit to God. And that's James 4:17, to the government, Romans 13:1-5, and 1 Peter 2:13-15. I want to turn to 1 Peter 2:13-15. And the reason is that I want to turn there is because most people understand, you've read Romans 13:1-5, where the scripture says that we're to submit to the government and to authorities as unto the Lord, because all authority is instituted of God. Most people will stop when the red lights come on. Amen. The smart ones will, okay? Most people will submit to the law. Most people will submit to the IRS. Most people will submit to, you know, governmental authorities in whatever respect that they need to. They understand that, and they're familiar with Romans 13. But I want you to look at 1 Peter 2:13-15, because I think it's an interesting passage. It says, therefore, submit yourselves to every ordinance of man, for the Lord's sake, whether to the king as supreme or to governors, as to those who were sent by him for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of those who do good. For this is the will of God, that by doing good you may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. So the scripture is telling us there that even the laws and even the things that government sets in place, that they are there to punish people who break the law, and we're to submit to them. Sometimes there are going to be laws that you don't think are necessary. Sometimes there are going to be laws that you think are a little bit nitpicky or unreasonable. But the Bible says go ahead and submit to them anyway, because they are there for a purpose and a reason. Now, the only time you wouldn't submit to a government law is when it itself is in contradiction to the higher laws of God. And that's the reason I wanted to read this, which would be laws like legalizing abortion, which would be laws like legalizing same-sex marriage and things of that nature. You wouldn't, as a Christian, say, well, you know what? I didn't believe in same-sex marriage. But now that it's legal, the Bible says you submit to the laws of the land, so I'm going to get me a husband. That would be like me saying that. Okay? Now it's okay for Christians to marry men. Men to marry men, and Christian men to marry men, and women to marry men, women, even if you're Christian, because God says you submit to the government in Romans chapter 13. That's not what that means. Okay? You always appeal to the higher law. God's already made that clear, right? Everybody understand that? Okay? So, just because the government makes a law that contradicts God's eternal law, doesn't mean you go with the lower law, because there appears to be another scripture or something that supports something that establishes that law. You have to balance that with the full counsel of the Word. Y'all understand that? Because every once in a while you'll see some cockamamie crazy person come along and twist the scriptures and try to support something that contradicts a higher law in the scripture with some principle over here in the scripture, but you have to have a full counsel. You have to have scripture, you know, supporting scripture in order to establish a principle. So I think that's important to point out. This is a lot of what happens in a lot of these homosexual gay churches and fellowships, where, you know, they say that God doesn't have a problem with homosexuals, that, you know, God created all people and they're born that way. The Bible doesn't support that, but they claim that it does. And so it don't fly, okay? So anyway, it's Christian wives are to support, are to submit to their masters. And that's 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 18. And this is, servants, be submissive to your masters with all fear, not only to the good and gentle, but also to the harsh. Now, this doesn't apply to us as much today, obviously, because we don't have slaves and masters and things like that today. But you could almost apply this to like employer situations today. So the idea is that if you as a wife are working for someone else, then the Bible obviously is saying that when you're on the job, you can submit to your employer. You understand what I'm saying? Sometimes there would be situations where people were slaves. There were slaves in the time that the scripture was written. And so the lady would submit to the master, just like in slave times in our country, which we don't have that anymore. But the slave wife would submit to the master, but she may have a husband at home. They'd go home at night to their family, you know. And so, you know, you would submit to the master. And then you had to their elders. So Christian wives would submit to elders. And you do the same thing today. The wife is to submit to the elders, which implies not just older people, but elders within the church of God. Now, obviously, first of all, she submits to her husband. And first of all, the scripture admonishes the woman to appeal to her husband if she has spiritual issues and spiritual needs. But she also is to submit to the elders, just like her husband is to submit to the elders in the local church. How many of you follow what I'm saying? So a woman wouldn't say, I'm only under the covering of my husband. I don't have to listen to you, Pastor Billy. Okay? Of course she does. He's there to feed her soul. He's there to lead and to guide and to look over her, just like he is her children and her husband. He's the shepherd of the under-shepherd of the local church. How many of you hear what I'm saying? Okay, and so also one another, which we're categorizing these, but also categorizing the husband is in the same position. Amen. The husband is submitted to the elders in the local church. The husband is submitted. We're submitted to one to another. As a matter of fact, remember Ephesians 5:21, submitting one to another as unto the Lord. Remember? So husbands submit one to another, don't they? I'm submitted to Pastor Billy. Pastor Billy and I have been friends for about 100 years. Pastor Billy, to me, is I don't trust anybody's counsel more than I trust his. You know what I'm saying? I submit to that. What he says to me carries so much weight. Y'all see what I'm saying? So that's the way I feel about him. Well, but I also submit to his wife. I feel like that she has incredible counsel and wisdom, and I feel the same way about her. But she's another woman, you know, so I don't go, you're a wife, you know? You're a wife. I can't see what you say. I don't feel that at all. I'm submitting. We're submitting one to another. Y'all see what I'm saying? So submitting one to another as unto the Lord. We do this without nagging. I'm talking about the wives. They submit without nagging, with gentleness and quietness. That's 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. And we're right here, so let's read that. It says, wives, likewise, be submissive to your own husbands, that even if some do not obey the word, they without a word may be won by the conduct of their wives. When they observe your chaste conduct accompanied by fear, do not let your adornment be merely outward, arranging hair, wearing gold, or putting on the apparel. So the main idea is don't try to find ways to win out in the conversation or on the issue. Don't do it by the way you dress or the way you look. Don't do it through nagging or arguing or any other type of way, but just be gentle and quiet and trust that God will be your spokesperson. Trust that God will highlight and emphasize the truth in what you have to say. I understand and I know that being a woman, that God has created you, ladies, in a special and a very unique and wonderful way. And that God wants to be your defender. God wants to be your advocate. And He has given you a special level of faith that because He asks you to submit to your husband, He will be your defender and your advocate. And He wants you to have such a trust and such a confidence in Him that when you will be quiet and meek, and even if your husband is being overbearing and not being fair, God says, I'll be your advocate. He says, if you'll trust me, I'll intervene between you and your husband, or you and men in general, and I'll come to your defense. But if you rise up, you know, and try to manipulate or defend yourself in other means that, you know, are like we described, then you are going to interfere with God's ability to defend you and advocate for you. Amen? And so really what God's saying is let me do for you what I want to do for you. So it's a special gift, I believe, that God wants to give you and help you with. Even if your husband's not a Christian, is what it's saying, or not a believer. So with respect, even as Sarah respected Abraham in 1 Peter 3, 5 through 6. So let's read that. Most of you know this passage, but I like it. It says, who are kept by the power... Wait a minute, I'm in the wrong place. 1 Peter 3, 5 through 6. Turn the page, Lee. For in this manner, in former times, the holy women who trusted in God also adorned themselves, being submissive to their own husbands. As Sarah obeyed Abraham, calling him Lord, whose daughters you are if you do good and are not afraid with any terror. Husbands likewise... dwell with them with understanding, giving honor to the wife as to the weaker vessel, and as being heirs together of the grace of life, that your prayers may not be hindered. So that's good, amen. So Sarah did this, and a lot of the women of old, not old women, but women of old, this is how they adorned themselves. They adorned themselves by allowing the Lord to be their covering, the Lord to be their beauty, the Lord to be their advocate and their defense. Amen? That's good stuff, isn't it? Praise God. Nothing will make you look better, and nothing will make you more heard and more believed and convincing than the Lord. So that's good. Amen? So when wives fail to submit, it's not fitting in the Lord. Colossians 3:18 says this, wives, submit to your own husbands as is fitting in the Lord. And then it goes on to speak to husbands and says, husbands, love your wives and do not be bitter toward them. So it's fitting in the Lord. The Greek is aneko or aniko, to pertain to what is due, duty as fitting. So it's just what's due, amen. And in keeping with Jesus' own teachings and an example in Matthew 20, 25 through 28. So if we look at that, that's Matthew 20, 25 through 28. Matthew 20, 25 through 28 says, but Jesus called them to himself and said, you know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and those who are great exercise authority over them. Yet it shall not be so among you, but whoever desires to become great among you, let him be your servant. And whoever desires to be first among you, let him be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. Amen. So this was Jesus' example. Jesus subjected himself. Jesus served. Amen. In order that God could do what he wanted to do with Jesus. But when we put ourselves in the forefront, when we put ourselves, you know, ahead, then it takes God's ability away